So again, thank you all for joining us here tonight. Tonight's program is called Sea Otters Returned from Near Extinction, an Adorable Comeback Story. Sea otters are adorable, furry, marine mammals that have once that were once hunted for their prized fur during the 1700s and 1800s and nearly went extinct. Only now, nearly a century after hunting ceased, are populations showing stable growth in some places. Sea otters are a keystone species in coastal areas, feeding on sea urchins, clams, crabs, and other crustaceans. I haven't read that word before, but I've heard it. When they are present, kelp beds are thick and healthy, providing homes for an array of sea life. But when otters disappear, sea urchins take over, and the kelp disappears along with all of the creatures that live in the beds. Now, thanks to their protected status, sea otters are making a comeback in California, Washington, and Alaska. A science journalist, Todd McLeish, will share stories, photos, and videos of his journey along the Pacific coast to track the status, health, habits, personality, and viability of sea otters. Todd is a science writer with 4 published books, all on natural history topics, including narwhals, basking with humpbacks, and golden wings and hairy toes, New England wildlife. He is a popular public speaker on cruise ships and at museums and environmental centers, and has published articles on wildlife topics in dozens of publications, including Earthwatch Journal, Birdwatcher's Digest, Wild Bird, and Rhode Island Monthly. And if I neglected to mention this, he is the author of the book that tonight's presentation is based on, called The Return of the Sea Otter. So all 20 of us or so, let's give a big round of applause to Todd for joining us here tonight. And Todd, you can mercifully take it away.
All right. Thank you so much. Hey, thanks everybody for joining me here today. This is a wonderful opportunity to fill you in on my favorite creature, maybe one of my favorite creatures. I'm not quite sure this qualifies as the number one, but certainly this has been an animal that has I've sort of been enamored of for many years. And when I, you know, for me, as a science writer who writes about wildlife almost every day, the best part of my job is that I get to go and hang out with biologists and help them with their research, get hands-on with some of these wild creatures, and then go home and write about them. So I've got some wonderful adventures to tell you about as we go along today. But, you know, when I first started telling people, in fact, let me start sharing my screen so we can all see some adorable pictures. Bear with me. There we go. So when I first started writing this book, I was telling my family and friends that this was what I was planning to do. And the first reaction that everybody said as soon as I said the word sea otter was, aww, because everybody knows how cute and adorable these guys are. That's clearly their reputation. But sea otters are so much more than just cute and adorable little creatures. Wait a minute, can I advance this? There we go. They are so much more than just cute and adorable creatures, although this certainly fits into that cute category. You see, otters are filled with superlatives. They are the smallest of the marine mammals, but they are actually a lot larger than most people imagine. They're about 5 feet long, so a bigger animal than most people would imagine. They're the heaviest of all of the weasel family members, about 100 pounds, so again, larger than most people imagine. They are the only marine mammal that doesn't have any blubber, because they don't need blubber. They are the animal with the densest fur of any creature on Earth, 1 million hairs per square inch. They, let's see, what else? Lots and lots of other superlatives. They're the only marine mammal that uses its paws to catch its food instead of its mouth. And, well, there are others too. But it just gives you an idea that these are indeed remarkable creatures and worth their superlatives beyond just the fact that they are among the cutest as well. Now, as Robert was saying, one of the most important messages that I'm taking home, or I want you to take home today, is that sea otters are a keystone species. And that means that they are unusually influential in maintaining the health of the habitat that they live in. So if you look at this picture and you look on the left side, that's a healthy kelp forest. This is the much of the habitat along the Pacific coast. It's got kelp that grows from the seafloor, maybe 100 feet tall to the surface of the water. It's got sea lions and sea otters and seals swimming through it with lots of different kinds of fish. It's got wonderful, amazing little invertebrate creatures at the bottom. And that's a healthy kelp forest with dozens and dozens of species. But if you remove those sea otters, which we've done, and we'll talk about that in a moment, all of a sudden, the sea urchin numbers grow because otters love to eat urchins. If the otters are gone, the urchin numbers grow. The urchin's favorite food is the kelp. If they eat all the kelp, then all the other species disappear, and you end up with what's on the right side of the picture, what we refer to as an urchin barrens. Nothing else in the environment except a bunch of unhealthy sea urchins. Bring the otters back, which we've done, and the otters start eating the urchins. The kelp starts to grow again, and we have and all the rest of the species return. So it really is unusual that one species plays such an important role in maintaining the health of their ecosystem. But that's exactly what sea otters do. And that's what the term a keystone species is all about. So after I learned about the importance that these guys play, I of course then had to go and explore this environment. And so I went scuba diving. This is in Monterey Bay, California. I'm the one on the right side there. If this was a video, you'd see me shaking a little bit because it was my very first scuba dive ever. And I was with a couple of guides and we got out there. Again, I wanted to see this environment to get a better understanding of what it looked like and how all the creatures were interacting down there. And so we sunk down. We were about 40 feet deep and we sunk down to the bottom of the water and started to explore. And it was amazing. I mean, there was lots of creatures everywhere. There were starfish the size of pizza boxes. There was wonderful little creatures called nudibranches, sea slugs that were bright pastel colors, bright fluorescent colors. There was fish at all different levels of the water column. Lots of other creatures around. It was a spectacular sight to see. Now, remember, it was my first dive, and I was pretty nervous, and I think I was sucking air really fast. And I got a little nervous. I signaled to the guides with me that I needed to go up to the surface. I needed to adjust my equipment. And so we get up to the surface and I fix my equipment. I ease my anxiety a little bit. And just as we were getting ready to go back down below, we turned around and right at the surface, we looked and saw this guy. This was an otter who was only about 10 or 15, well, maybe 10 yards away from us, quite close. And he had been, he had been just snoozing at the surface of the water when we arrived at the surface, and he looked up and he then went about his normal day. And it was wonderful to see all the amazing behaviors that these guys exhibit. Now, sea otters can dive about 300 feet deep. They can spend about 5 minutes underwater at a time, although seldom do they spend that much time under or go that deep. Otters, for the most part, live within the first half a mile of the shoreline, and so that the water isn't particularly deep then. They typically are in water of about 100 feet or less in depth, and their dives are typically only, you know, a minute or two, but they can dive to 300 feet. They can stay under for 5 minutes or so. These are animals that are voracious in their diet. It's how they control the sea urchin populations from getting out of control. They must eat 30% of their weight every single day in order to maintain their metabolism and their health. And of course, a 100-pound animal, that means he has to eat 30 pounds of shellfish every day. That's an awful lot of food. If we had to eat 30 pounds of our weight, that would be an awful lot, I suspect. So, and again, they're eating primarily shelled creatures, clams and crabs and all sorts of other shelled creatures like mussels that we see here, and sea urchins, and abalone, all sorts of shelled creatures. And one of the things they're most famous for is they bring those shelled items to the surface, and they use their belly like a picnic table, and they crack open their food and eat it at the surface. This is one of the few mammals that uses tools. It will find a rock or some other hard object, and it will use it to crack open the shellfish on their belly, on their chest, while they're lying at the surface of the water. And one of the most amazing things is they have a favorite tool that they use to open their favorite items. And so they actually have a pouch in their armpit to store their favorite tool. So they swim down to the bottom, find the shellfish, bring it to the surface, pull the tool out of their armpit, use it to crack open their that shellfish, put the tool back in their armpit, and dive back down to get another shellfish. It's remarkable that they have a favorite tool, and sometimes they even have a favorite tool for each different kind of prey. One tool to open up clams, another tool to open up crabs, another tool to open up abalone, for instance. And this flap of skin under their armpit allows them to store their favorite tools. Pretty remarkable, these guys. Now, sea otters in their reproductive cycle I guess I got to say that being a female sea otter is not an enjoyable event, I suspect. Sea otters, you can generally tell the difference between the males and the females because the females, although you don't see it in this picture, generally have scars on their nose because males, when they are mating, will bite down on the female's nose to hold her down. And essentially, females spend their entire lives after age 2, either pregnant or raising a pup. So essentially, they mate. It's a 6-month gestation period. They give birth. The mother is weaning that pup, feeding that pup for about 6 months until it's weaned and independent and ready to go off on its own. And by then, the mother is pregnant again. It's a rough life, I guess, in that situation. But nonetheless, they typically give birth to one pup at a time, although this is one of those unusual pictures where there's actually 2 pups right there on their belly. They typically live for maybe 10 or 12 years in the wild, maybe as long as 15 years as an adult, I'm sorry, as in captivity. And sadly, as I described those mating activities in terms of biting down on the nose, that unfortunately is one of the leading causes of death, strangely enough, of sea otters, is mating injuries from the males that actually are ripping the nose right off of the female. So it's a disturbing sight and an unfortunate circumstance, but that unfortunately is the life of the female sea otter. Now, as I said, sea otters are indeed have this remarkable fur, and that's one of the things that they're most famous for. They have this coat that's 1 million hairs per square inch, the densest fur of any animal on Earth. If you think about a typical human head, we have maybe 100,000 hairs on our entire head, and I, of course, have a lot fewer than that at the moment, but sea otters have 1 million hairs per square inch. It's why they don't need any blubber. That fur coat provides them with the insulating capacity of the thick blubber of a seal or a sea lion. It's a very dense coat. It's a coat that is very heavy. It probably weighs 25 or 30 pounds, just the fur coat itself. And it keeps them super warm, but it means that they can't spend very much time out of the water. They spend about 98% of their time in the water because when they come out of the water, particularly when it's sunny, they overheat. They get so much heat from the sun, from the daytime temperatures, that their coat essentially makes them overheat. So they've got to stay close to the water and stay in that water as much as they can. Now, of course, this fur coat makes them very buoyant, especially the pups. In fact, the pups have a natal fur that is so buoyant, that makes them so buoyant, that when they want to swim down under the water to follow their mother down to the bottom to find food, the pups just pop to the surface like a cork. So it's kind of cute to be able to watch that. But nonetheless, this coat requires constant grooming. If you're looking at a sea otter at the surface of the water, it's either sleeping or eating or grooming. They really have to take care of that fur coat to maintain it so that it doesn't get dirtied up, so that it will continue to shed water. You know, the fur coat is so so good at keeping water from their skin that they can live their entire life and never have water touch their skin. The sort of the architecture of the fur allows it to keep that water away from their skin. And so in order to continue to do that, they need to groom and maintain that fur as best they can. Now, the unfortunate thing is that the sea otter's fur coat is also its greatest vulnerability. And as Robert mentioned, we had a period of time when sea otter furs were in great demand, and that almost led to their extinction. And let me tell you a quick story about how that happened. So it's the late 1700s, and in China, there is a great demand for furs of all sorts. And most of those furs were provided by trappers in Siberia, in Russia, that would be trapping rabbits and foxes and other animals and bringing those furs to China. But when those Russian trappers found their way to the east coast of Kamchatka, which is a peninsula on the east coast of Russia, and I'll show you a map in just a moment, they discovered sea otters. And when they killed those otters and brought the furs to China, they could make so much more money for those furs than for any other animal. And so they started to hunt as many otters as they could. They then followed the Aleutian Islands of Alaska across the Pacific, hunting sea otters there and bringing those to China. At the same time, You've heard of Captain Cook. He was the first European to explore the North Pacific, and he arrived on the coast of British Columbia at about the same time, 1785. And as this picture indicates, he was trading there with the Native Americans there on British Columbia coastline along the Southeast Alaska coastline. And when he brought those furs that he got in trade with the natives, and brought those to China, he realized how much money he could make out of them. And that launched a ship-based industry trade in sea otter furs. Ships from Boston and London went all the way around South America, came up the West Coast, and started buying and trading for sea otter furs. And over the course of 50 years, between the Russian trappers and the American traders, we basically wiped out nearly the entire global population of sea otters. We went from a worldwide population of about 250,000 sea otters down to about 1,000 sea otters. And by that time, there weren't enough otters left to be able to sustain a commercial hunt. And the fashion styles were kind of changing at that time. Furs were not nearly as much in demand. And so otters finally had an opportunity to begin to rebound a little bit. Now, if you look at this map, this gives you a little bit of a sense of where the otters were and where they are now. And originally, the otter range started all down along the Mexico coast, down to Baja California, all the way up the west coast of North America to Alaska, out that Aleutian Island chain over to the Kamchatka Peninsula that you can see part of Russia, and down to the northern islands of Japan. That's where the range of the otter was before the fur trade started. At the end of the fur trade, there were just a very few little spots where otters were found here on the Aleutian Islands, maybe two or three spots on the Aleutian Islands, and then over to Prince William Sound in central Alaska coastline. That was the entire range of the otters at the end of the fur trade. Over the and that was about, you know, about 1900. Over the last 100 years, they have begun to recover. And you can see in the crosshatched areas of the map where the otters have returned to. They're in the central California coastline, but they're not down to Mexico anymore. They're not in Northern California or Oregon, but they are on the coast of Washington. They're up along the British Columbia coastline, all of the southern Alaska coastline, out to Kamchatka. And they're just beginning to return to the northern islands of Japan. And so for me, as I began doing this research to learn about these animals, what was particularly notable was that there's a different story to tell about the otters in different parts of the range and how they recovered and the issues that they're facing. So I thought I'd tell you a few stories about that, because I did travel most of this range in order to do my studies to research to be able to write this book. And so let's start with California. And the California population was believed to have been totally wiped out during the fur trade, that there were no otters left at the end of the fur trade. But in 1938, there was a couple who bought a telescope right along the coast of the Big Sur between Monterey Bay and Morro Bay in California. And they practiced with their new telescope looking out onto the water, and they saw about 20 sea otters. At that time, 1938, it was believed there were no sea otters in the California coastline, but they discovered about 20 or so otters, and they immediately were protected by the government, and that population has grown and expanded. They've moved their way northward and southward, and over the last 100 years or 80 years, those otters have expanded their numbers to be about 3,000. So there's now 3,000 otters from the original 20 along the California coastline. And you can see by the map that they've expanded their way northward towards San Francisco, but they haven't quite gotten there yet, and southward towards Los Angeles, but they haven't quite gotten there yet. And the reason they haven't expanded any farther, I mean, that middle range where they are found, there are so many otters there that there's not enough food to support them. So they're trying to expand their range northward and southward. But unfortunately, at that exact spot in the map, at the northern end of their range right now, just north of Monterey Bay, there's a seal rookery. And at the southern end of their range right now, there is a seal rookery. And when there are seal rookeries, there are great white sharks there to eat the seals. And unfortunately, when the otters arrived in those areas, the sharks started to kill the otters. So the otters are trying to expand their range northward and southward. Unfortunately, the presence of the sharks has kept them from expanding. And in fact, shark bites are now the leading cause of death of sea otters in California. And sadly, the sharks don't even benefit and get the nutrition from the otters. They take one big bite. They say, oh, this is a big fur ball. I don't want this. And they spit it out. The bite is enough to kill the animal, but the carcass essentially washes ashore. So that's really the great concern right now is otters. There are large numbers of otters in the middle of their range. They're trying to expand their range to north and south, but the sharks aren't allowing them to do that. So the population is somewhat limited by the presence of the sharks. Now, because there's so many otters in the middle part of that range, they are that's where the researchers are studying these animals. That's where why we know so much about sea otters, so much more about sea otters than any other marine mammal, is because they are so easily accessed to study and learn about them. And so I spent some time on the California coast of Monterey Bay, California, with some biologists who were capturing otters. We actually, this picture on the left here, you see this otter in a trap. It was quite an amazing experience to help out and trap sea otters. I should point out that as cute as sea otters are, when they're in a trap, they're not at all cute at all. They're quite vicious animals. But we brought the otter from the waters. We brought them into the Monterey Bay Aquarium to the veterinarian at the aquarium who was doing a little health studies of the otters. And then he did a quick little surgical procedure to implant a tracking device in the otter. And then an hour later, we returned the otter back out to the water. It was amazing to be so close up to these otters and get to touch that fur of a live animal. And then once that animal was back in the water and had this tracking device in it, it allowed the biologist to monitor its movements every single day for several years to learn about their movements, to learn where they're going, what habitat they're in, what other otters they're interacting with, how often do they dive, what are they eating each day. It's amazing what you can learn by simply tracking and watching an animal regularly and just observing all their behaviors. And so that's why we know so much about sea otters, is because they are so close to shore, so easy to observe, and the researchers are using these tracking devices to learn so much about them. Now, that's the California story. But if we go north a bit and we go up to the state of Oregon, where sea otters were indeed totally wiped out of the coastline population there. The population was entirely wiped out after the fur trade. And by the late 1960s, early 1970s, there were efforts over 3 years in a row to reintroduce otters from the Aleutian Islands in Alaska, where the population had rebounded quickly, and bring a few otters down to the Oregon coast to reestablish them there. They, over 3 years, they brought 90 otters, and just 12 of them survived for only a couple of years. And 3 years later, they were all gone. Whether they all tried to swim back to Alaska, whether they died for one reason or another, nobody knows. But there still, to this day, are no otters left on the coast of Oregon. Similar story in Washington. Otters were wiped out during the fur trade. They were reintroduced in the 60s and 70s. A few more survived there and continued to survive and reproduce. And now, today, we have about 1,800 sea otters along the Washington coast, just on that outer coastline where the Olympic Peninsula is, sort of the northern part of the Washington outer coastline. And they seem to be doing well, and they seem to be reproducing and have a healthy population. The woman here on the right is a researcher who I spent some time with, a grad student from the University of Washington, who was watching otters from a promontory and trying to study their dietary choices, you know, 30 or 40 years after the otters had been reintroduced to the area. You know, when they first got there, there was plenty of big food available because the otters hadn't been around to keep those urchins in check. 40 years later, they've got fewer and smaller prey items. And so she was trying to assess what these otters are eating 40 years on after they had been reintroduced to the area. Now, if we go a little bit farther north to British Columbia, similar story. All the otters were wiped out during the fur trade. They were reintroduced in the 60s and 70s, and a couple, maybe 120 something of those reintroduced otters survived. And now there are 6,500 sea otters along the coast of British Columbia. And that really was a remarkable effort to restore these animals, and they have done so incredibly well. The picture on the left is a man named, oh no, I just forgot his name. Never mind. He's a biologist for some of the native tribes along the British Columbia coastline, and he invited me to join him to on his sailboat. This is him. I'm shooting this picture of him from the cabin of his sailboat. We sailed along the British Columbia coastline, studying the otters, counting them, surveying them, observing their populations. And one of the things I learned is I'm a very bad sailor. It scared me to death going out on that outer coastline of the water and of British Columbia. And I'm glad I got back to land safely. But nonetheless, it was fun to learn about the otters along that coast and the issues that they're facing. And then we went even further north. And this is along the coast of Southeast Alaska. And it had a very similar story. If you can picture the state of Alaska, it has that long sort of panhandle edge of the Southeast Alaska corner that scoots along the edge of the coast of British Columbia. That's the Southeast Alaska portion of the range where otters again had been wiped out during the fur trade, were reintroduced at six different locations along that Southeast Alaska corner. And those otters have boomed. Over the course of the last 40 years, those otters boomed. We now have 25,000 sea otters in Southeast Alaska. And the guys in this picture are not happy because, of course, when we went for 100 years without any otters in the area, the sea urchin numbers boomed. And it turns out that the folks in Japan like to eat sea urchins. And so we created a commercial fishery for sea urchins. And you can see all those urchins on the left picture there. It's a dive fishery, so the guys actually dive down to the bottom of the water and pick up the urchins and put them in bags and bring them to the surface. Well, when the otters were returned to the areas in the 70s, and their numbers have been growing very quickly since then, the otters are taking over. They are eating all the urchins. Or not all the urchins, but their fair share of urchins. And, of course, the fishermen aren't as good a fisherman as the sea otters are. And so there's a big conflict going on, so much so that the fishermen are losing their catch. They're not making as much money as they used to. They have to keep moving around and finding areas where there aren't otters around. It's gotten so bad that they've petitioned the government to start a bounty on sea otters. You know, kill some sea otters and cut off their nose and you bring in a nose and you get paid $25 or something, trying to keep the otter population in check. that hasn't gone through because, of course, otters are in the endangered list and they're protected, so a bounty won't be enacted. But it just shows you the conflicts that otters have created as they have rebounded in numbers and recovered and returned to areas where they hadn't been seen for 100 years or more. And in a similar vein, in the same part of Southeast Alaska, the otters are being hunted by Native Alaskans. They actually have an exemption from the Endangered Species Act and the Marine Mammal Protection Act because of their traditional practice of hunting for otters and using their furs for various clothing items and other tchotchkes. And so they are indeed still hunting otters. The thing is, of course, that we went for 100 years with no otters in the area. And so that practice wasn't passed down from generation to generation anymore. So there aren't very many Native Alaskans now that are trying to hunt. It's just sort of, they're just beginning to reinstall this practice. And the guy on the right there, his name is Peter Williams, and he's become so famous as a sea otter hunter, teaching others to hunt sea otters, other natives to hunt sea otters, but also he's a fashion designer. He's actually has fashion shows on New York City runways every year, showing off the fashions he makes from sea otter furs. Not something that I'm particularly thrilled with, killing sea otters. I love these guys. I want to protect these animals. But it is legal and a practice that these Native Alaskans are allowed to continue to do. Now, if we continue our tour northward, we now need to head westward along the Aleutian Islands of Alaska, that long 1,800-mile stretch of islands that extends all the way across almost to Russia. That's where the otter numbers were largest before the fur trade. That's where there were three or four otter populations that still remained tiny numbers of them, but they were still enough to recover. That's where they recovered fastest after the fur trade. And by the 1960s, there were about 100,000 sea otters on the Aleutian Islands. They had rebounded really well. Unfortunately, beginning in the 70s and through the 1980s, those numbers started to crash, and nobody could figure out why. We went from about 100,000 otters down to what we believe there are today, only 6,000 sea otters. We dropped the population by 95%, essentially, and nobody really knew why. And it took years of research and observation to discover that the reason for that decline is killer whales. On the right there, you see a killer whale. On the left is a couple of sea otters. Killer whales are also an endangered species. They are somewhat common along the Aleutian Islands. And killer whales typically eat seals and other kind of marine mammals, not sea otters. Sea otters are a little piece of popcorn to them. They're not big enough for them to bother with. But it was believed that one family unit of killer whales, that's all it would have taken, one family unit of killer whales, if they switched their diet from seals to sea otters, that could have been responsible for the entire decline of the sea otter population along the Aleutian Islands. One group of a dozen or so killer whales. That's what is believed to have happened. And so there's a great concern. What do we do now? We have two endangered species, one that's eating the other one. We can't really do anything to the killer whale to protect the otters. This is just sort of nature taking its course. And so it's a really big challenge. The biologists are basically saying, we just need to let nature take its course. Eventually, we hope that the otter numbers will get so low that the killer whales will switch their diet back to seals and allow the otter numbers to rebound. So it really is a challenging issue, and it's a sad one that we can't really do anything about because it is just nature doing what nature does, unfortunately. So the other big thing that I discovered as I was learning about the different storylines in each part of their range is that the health issues are different in each part of their range. I got to observe a couple of sea otter autopsies. The blonde woman on the left, that's actually my wife helping out with the autopsy. But what I learned from this experience was that, again, different health issues in each different part of their range. If you are an otter in Alaska, and you don't die from a killer whale, then the leading cause of death is the Streptococcus virus or bacterium. The same thing that gives us strep throat kills sea otters. How it gets in the sea otter, nobody knows, but that is the leading cause of death of sea otters in Alaska, if you're not dying from a killer whale bite. If you're in California, no otters in California are dying from killer whales or from strep. Instead, the leading cause of death, as I said, is shark bites. If you're an otter in California and you're not dying from shark bite, you're dying from something called toxoplasmosis, which strangely enough comes from kitty poop. Somehow it gets from our house cats into their kitty litter. It's a bacterium that's in their the lining of their intestine. So as they defecate, that bacterium goes along with them into their litter box. It eventually somehow finds its way into rivers and streams. It goes down the river and stream into the bay. That bacterium gets into the shellfish, and the otter eats the shellfish. It's become such a serious problem in California that if you were to buy a box of kitty litter in California, it has a special label on it to indicate the proper way of disposing of kitty litter so that it doesn't affect the sea otter population. So it really is a huge issue facing the otters in California. And again, different health issues facing otters in different parts of the range. And if you're an otter in Washington or British Columbia, you're not dying from any of the reasons I just talked about. And so again, strange things happening in different parts of the range. But the biggest story really is, or the biggest threat really is oil spills. The Exxon Valdez oil spill in 1989 killed more than 4,000 sea otters, and it took them 25 years to recover their population to be the numbers that they had before the spill happened. What happens is that when oil gets on their skin, you know that that fur is so important to them, the oil mats down their fur. They either try to groom their fur and they get the oil inside them, or the cold water gets through to their skin, they die of hypothermia. Either way, they're a goner. And so oil spills are the greatest threat facing sea otters. One oil spill on the Washington coast would quickly wipe out the entire 1,800 animals on that small part of the range there. It would take a big spill on the California coastline in exactly the wrong spot to wipe out that population. But, you know, 3,000 otters, that's smaller than the number that died in Prince William Sound. So it really is a great concern going forward for these animals. Now I want to show you this picture, an adorable little baby sea otter pup. And that's me in that photograph wearing what the biologists refer to as the Darth Vader outfit. Because along the coast of California, and I believe in a couple places in Alaska as well, where baby sea otters somehow get separated from their mother and wash up on shore, they are recovered by whoever can find them, whoever can collect them, state biologists, park rangers, and others, and brought to the local aquarium where they are raised in captivity using surrogate mothers and then released back into the wild once they're independent and able to go off on their own. And I got to tell you, this picture here was the most adorable 20 minutes of my entire life. I was standing there holding this baby otter getting to feed it and getting to help to groom this little thing. You got to teach these guys how to groom themselves, and you get to give them a little massage, and you rub their flippers and their feet, and you get to use a little hair dryer to dry them off and to give them a little warmth. Then you put them in the water for a little bit to go to the bathroom, and you take them back out again. You use a brush and a comb, and it is adorable. If you ever want the best job in the universe, you want to be the baby otter groomer at Monterey Aquarium. Give that a try. Nonetheless, the real reason for this picture, besides the adorableness of this little guy, is that the folks at the aquarium really do a great job of recovering these otters, helping them to learn how they do what they need to do in order to mature and then be able to go back out into the wild. We wear that Darth Vader outfit so the otter doesn't realize it's being raised by a person in the early stages of his life. Earlier in the days when they were just starting this rehabilitation process of baby otters, they were done by people looking just like people. And when the otter was finally released into the wild, whenever it got hungry, it went and found the nearest fisherman or kayaker or person and begged for food. So clearly that was not working out, hence the Darth Vader outfit. Now, let me just wrap up with two last slides. And this is not a sea otter. This is a river otter. And you can sort of get a sense that they are similar. They're clearly related, but they're not the same. There are actually 13 kinds of otters around the world. The river otter is the most common and abundant one in North America, found all the way across the country in on land and in freshwater. So the differences between sea otters and river otters spend half their life on land, half their life in freshwater. They don't go into the ocean. Sea otters spend almost all of their time in the ocean, in saltwater. So that's one distinction. If you're, depending on what body of water you're looking at, you can generally tell whether it's a sea otter or a river otter. River otters give birth to 3 or 4 pups at a time, sea otters to 1 at a time. River otters swim on their belly, whereas sea otters swim on their backs. And for me, once you see a lot of river otters and a lot of sea otters, you really can tell at a quick glance to distinguish the two of them. For me, this particular guy here, look at him. He is sleek. He's got his hair brushed back. He is ready to go out and party. He is just a smooth-looking guy headed out to wherever he needs to go. And then we have the sea otters, who are definitely a bit shaggier looking, not nearly as sleek looking as the river otter, but they still win in the cuteness factor. And I just want to leave you with this picture right here and note, look at all of those noses. This is a group of male sea otters, no scarred noses to be seen among them. And it's only the males that will really gather in large groups like this. The females tend to stick it out with the other females and with their pups. But I want to leave you with a message about the future of sea otters, because that's one question that I always ask all the biologists I speak with, regardless of what animal they're studying. What does the future hold for this animal? And when I asked that question of a half a dozen biologists who study sea otters, they all basically said the same thing. They all said, the future for sea otters is, well, they're worried, they said. They said that otters spend their entire lives in that first half mile of shoreline, from the shore out a half a mile. And that's where humans have the greatest impact. We all want to move to the coastline. We all want to spend time in the water. That's where we have lots of shipping and recreation going on. We have a lot of fishing activity going on there. That's where there's the greatest impact from pollution of one sort or another, is in that nearshore environment. And that's where the sea otters spend their entire lives. And so the biologists are worried, as more and more people move to the shore, as more and more people as our population grows, there's great concerns about all of that impact on the otters. And yet, every biologist also said, and yet, they said, look at what we've done. Look at what we've thrown at them already, and they're still thriving. We hunted them to near extinction, and they've recovered. They're facing a number of human-related diseases, and they're still thriving. And so, yes, they're dealing with sharks, and yes, they're dealing with killer whales, but they seem to be able to recover quickly and respond as necessary. And so the outlook seems to be optimistic, despite all the challenges going forward. Climate change does not seem to be a great threat for them, and so the outlook seems to be somewhat optimistic. And part of that is, of course, they've got a big fan base. I hope that all of you out there watching this presentation are fans of otters. I suppose you wouldn't be here if you weren't. They've got lots of people that love these animals. And even the fishermen who are losing their catch to otters can't deny the cuteness factor and can't deny how adorable and wonderful these guys are, even though it's cutting into their paycheck. These animals are going to hopefully survive and thrive despite what we're throwing at them. You know, they've got this big fan base, and why wouldn't they have such a fan base? Because they're the cutest animals on earth. Thank you very much, everybody, for having me here today, for joining me. Hope you got a couple of awes and ahs out of all my cute otter pictures. Robert, I am ready for some questions whenever you are.
Great. Let me hit the stop record button.